Hello, everybody. So we're going to have Kalyan Prasad talking about advanced visualization in Jupyter Notebooks. Just now we had, a short talk about how Jupyter Notebooks were used in EDA, but did not in production. But it's a very, very vital role when you're, trying to start out on a data science problem. So let's have Kalyan coming up. Hi, Kalyan.
Hi.
Hi. So we're really looking forward to your talk, and you could take it right on. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you so much. I hope you see my slides.
Yes.
You can see my screen, right?
Yes, we are able to see your
Hello.
screen.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you so much.
Please go ahead. Thank you.
Yeah. So, hello everyone. I am Kalyan Prasad, and it's really incredible to be here and such an honor to be given this stage to speak to all of you here in PyCon India. So today I'm going to talk about advanced visualization in Jupyter Notebooks. So in this talk, we are going to look at some advanced ways to visualize our data. So before jumping into the actual content, let me quickly introduce about myself. So I'm a self-taught data scientist. So if what do you mean by self-taught data scientist, let me give you some quick hints on that. So I don't have a formal computer science background degree. I'm purely a non-technical guy. So I'm a commerce and finance guy. So and most of work which I practice in spreadsheets. So I have a almost like some decent experience in fintech, where my most of the role was into the Excel spreadsheets. But somehow I realized that I can do something beyond Excel. There I started my journey 2 years ago in data science. And that's how I turned up as a data scientist now, today. And I also love involving in tech communities and try to help communities as possible as I can do. So currently I'm associated with these two groups, Hyderabad Python User Group and also the PyConf for Hyderabad Organizing Committee. So feel free to check out these groups in case if you are interested. And I also, my areas of interest lies in AI and fintech. It's not just because of the buzzwords which are floating on the internet. It's just because how the world and industries are transforming with these technologies. Okay, so here is the agenda for today's talk. I tried writing my agenda in simple Python function. Okay, so here we start with the advanced visualization overview. Then we are going to give an introduction to information dense visualization. Then we are going to talk about visual data correlation. Then we are going to show a simple model linear regression. And we'll give you a quick demo of a concept what all we have covered here, and then we'll wrap up the things. Okay, without any further delays, let's get started. So advanced visualization overview. So data visualization is a huge field. You can see that just by looking at various Matplotlib examples on their website. Now, some of the key things to take away from this field without becoming an expert in data visualization are, it's a delicate skill. So you have to be careful and not to exaggerate, even though you have so many tools at your disposal. Sometimes using less is more. So sometimes using a simpler method, doing a cleaner plot shows more information in a clearer way rather than going for fanciest of all tools. On the other hand, don't underestimate your audience. So it is important to show various insights from our graphics. So we shouldn't just assume that the average reader of our document or a person who is going to look at our analysis report won't be able to understand the concepts we are describing. Instead, we should try to teach the audience how to read the more advanced graphs and don't underestimate them. And I like to think visualization as a way of storytelling. So think about what motivation of your researcher work is and basically how to use these plots to guide the reader to understand the concepts you have discovered during your data analysis. Introduction to information dense visualization. So a key person in data visualization theory is Edward Tufte. He has really mastered the skills and written multiple books. On the same matter, I would highly recommend if you can read his book, The Visual Display of Quantitative Information, which is really the prime source that really combined all of the important concepts here. So one of the important concepts he mentioned in his book is information density. So think of this way. If we have a pie chart like this, which basically shows the size of four items, so would it be better if we just replace this pie chart by four numbers? So the pie chart uses a lot of colors, a lot of effect, a lot of shadows here. At the end, it just conveys the information about four numbers. So I think it would have been better to use a table in this case or just describe the number in text. And So one of the graphics Stuft used in his book is Napoleon's March, which is created by Charles Joseph Maynard. So this graph basically shows the out of Napoleon's army losses in the Russian campaign of 1812. So this is the graph. It looked quite complex at first sight, but don't get scared. But what I mean, if we break it down, this graph, it basically shows the brown area shows the position of the army and the size of the army as it advanced towards Moscow. And if we look at the x-axis, it shows basically the geographical movement and the passage of time. And if you see the black color, it shows the retreat of the army after their loss. And we can see so many variables on this graph. This is called multivariate visualization. We can see the army size and its location over time. And if you also look at the small graph on the bottom, we can see the temperatures that related to army's retreat. So we can see the temperature is really, really getting cold towards the end of retreat phase. So this is an example of information dense graphic, which shows many aspects and basically tells a story in and of itself, which makes it a masterpiece of data visualization. Now, what sort of graphics we are going to deal with? I'll be quickly showing them once we cover the remaining concepts. So next we have is visual data correlation. So the main objective of this concept is to compare different methods of two data variables. Suppose if we are talking about time series data, the first thing would be visual comparison and to better understand the properties to compare. So let's see what time series is and what sort of patterns we can compare from it. So here is the example of sample time series plot. It already splits the first plot. Here you can see the original. And if we look at the second graph here, we can already see the seasonal effect or seasonality change. For example, if temperature changes during a year as season changes from spring to summer or winter. So these are certain patterns and we call these patterns if they are repeating over time. And then what we have is called the trend line, which is the third plot in this visualization. So trends can be long-term changes over time. So what I want to finally conclude here is if we are plotting the time series plot side by side, one way is to look at the properties to compare and then is to look at the properties and then compare by it. The method which we are going to basically show, which basically describes the trend more clearly, is known as the moving average method, which I'll be showing you in the Jupyter notebook. And the second plot, this is the second plot, which has the similarities between the data and the relationship is called scatter plot, which basically plot two variables, one on each axis. So here is an example of a scatter plot of income and education. So these are the data points. If we look at each data point, a person with particular education length in years and what their income is. So the scatter plot, what shows here is called correlation. So correlation is a statistical measure of association or dependence. So without going into much details about it, which goes beyond the scope of this talk, you can think of correlation visually. So here is the different plot examples of correlation data and their correlation value. So a perfect correlation of one would be the linear function, so which is the first example in our plot here. So if we look at the correlation with 0.8 value, where we can see a scatter plot and where we can also see some sort of a direction, where we can see some messy points here, there is a variance of data, outliers and so on. If we jump to the example of correlation zero here, where there is a circle of messy point, it clearly says that there is no relationship between variables in the scatter plot. And one thing that usually mentioned in relation to correlation is correlation does not imply causation. It means if two variables are correlated to each other, it doesn't mean that one affects the other or vice versa. So it is important to understand the data and the factors that affect it. Maybe there may be a common cause and so on. So this is a huge field of study. So we are going to look at simplified overview of what correlation is. Then what we have is called a model technique, which is a linear regression. So it's a method for fitting a simple mathematical model to our data. So the method which we are going to describe, show a model is called the linear function, which is called f of x is equal to ax plus b. If you show this graphically, it shows as it describes our data behavior by plotting a straight line, which basically follows the direction of scatter plot. Again, this is a simple use case, but if we look at reality, which is used in science, which is used to model the real world behavior on experimental data, so this is that's again a typical use case. So So what if this is a small step into the direction of actually doing the science of data science part. So what we have now finally is so what are the concepts which I have covered so far? So we'll be showing you with a practical demo. So for this demo, I have selected as a Chicago crime and Chicago weather data sets. And we'll first analyze these two data sets in relation to each other. Then we'll show our graphics with these two data sets. And finally, we'll show a simple linear model on the same. Okay, let me dive into my Jupyter notebook now. So here is a Jupyter notebook which I have created for this demonstration purpose. So firstly, I have imported the packages here, pandas, numpy, and matplotlib. Now we are reading the both data sets here. So one thing I would like to mention in this point is, so I have gone through this crime CSV file, and what I have noticed is basically the data was so uncertain, unordered, uncertain. So what I have done is I have made a small adjustment to this data while passing. So what I have done is, for this demonstration purpose, I've just selected only the 2016 year data and thrown away the rest due to the memory constraint, because this is a very huge data. So that's the reason I did this thing. So once I have passed this parsing here, so here you can see the crime data set with the final data frame here. Then for the weather data, while reading the weather data, I also selected the period 2016 so that we'll have the both data sets will have the same period. So once we read the data set here, now we are plotting the data side by side. So from weather data, I've selected the temperature column and resampling it by day and calculating the mean. So mean of a weather, I mean. So now if we plot this, so you can see we can see the seasonality effect that we'd expect from weather data. I mean, like it's gradually hotter over summer or winter over cooler. So, and also what I have done is I have also done the same thing for crimes as well. So I have resampled by day and counting the number of crime instances here. So here you can see the number of crime instances. So next, what I have done is to simplify the above variables, I have just created the two variables here and passed the data what I have shown above. So now we are plotting this on the same graph. So if you see this graph, so these two are different data types and the values are nowhere related to each other. So if you look at the temperature values, where the values are in the range of 10 to 20, and if you look at the crime values, where the values are in the range of 600 to 800. So now this is a problem. So what can we do in this case? So in theory, we could have added another y-axis and basically have both plots on the same graph with different y-axis. But again, that is considered to be a bad practice in data visualization. Instead, what we can do is we can create two subfigures for these two plots, and we will create a fixed size for that for each subfigure, and we pass the fixed size and other matplotlib properties like temperature and the label. So once we plot this, now we can clearly see that which data set belongs to which graph. And we can also notice now that the temperature and crime are one next to each other. So, I mean, to better, the thing which I mentioned in the slides is we are trying smoothing our time series plot to show trend more clearly. So we can do this by using the pandas rolling function. So we are calculating the moving average here. And so if we plot this, so it shows that certain points in the crime rates here, an average will be calculated. So the more you increase the number, the curve will be more smoothened. So the longer the period, the average is, the changes would be more gradual. And so what remains here is the trend change will be the long-term change. And I have also used the interactive widgets here to show the moving size adjustable window. So what I have done is I have imported the interact here. And for this interact, I have passed this argument so that it will create a nice interactive plot here. So we are calculating the moving average same here. So what I have done is I have basically selected the period 100 here. So probably you can play with this to check how the curve is smoothening here. So I selected the period 100. Now if you see, the curve is so smooth and it clearly shows there is a similarities between these two time series plot. It clearly says that there is a similarity between the temperature and crime. So to better express this, we can calculate the correlation or scatter plot as I mentioned previously. So what I have done is to do this, what I have done is I have selected these two time series and passed into a data frame. So one column for crimes and one column for temperature. So here is a data frame we have. So this we can be used to explore further analysis at the beginning now. So now, once we have a data frame, now what we can do is we can call the plot function. So instead of going default plot method, which is a time series plot for the time series data, so we have given kind of scatter here and also given the x-axis and y-axis. So here you can see the scatter plot. So if you observe the scatter plot for certain temperature on the same day, exactly what was the crime rate? So there is a clear trend here. I mean, there is a correlation happening here. So the lower the temperature rates, the lower the crime rates here. The higher the temperature rate, the number of crimes are higher here. So there is a definitely correlation happening here. So if you want to express this statistically, what we can do is we can call the core function here. So if I call the core function, so here you can see the correlation is 0.3. So by default, I have used the Pearson correlation here, but probably you can also explore the different methods of correlation. And I'm not going to dig much details about it, but what I see is, if you remember the slides which I have shown where numerical values of between 0 and 1, how correlated the data is. So if we come back to storytelling side, one thing that pops up in my mind is there is an outlier here. So if you observe, so the most of the data is clustered in this big area, suddenly we have a big outlier here. So outliers can always definitely lead to an interesting story. So probably to know the reason behind this outlier, so what I have done is, so I've just selected the data point greater than 1000. If you notice here, so the data point greater than 1000 is an outlier. So I just selected the data point greater than 1000. So if you look at results, it is a new year. So it seems like there is a large gathering happenings or a theft happening due to big crowds and all. But again, so this is just a 1 year data. It's also good to look at other year data before we make a conclusion here. And then finally, what we have is, we'll show you the model on top of it now. So for a linear model, what I'm doing is I imported the statistical model, stats model here, which basically shows some statistical functions. And I also imported the AB line plot. Okay. So now we are giving the, so we have only one constant variable here. So we are going to give the temperature as an input. So the output would be the crime rate here. So when I call the model.fit here, we'll see the model results object and followed by the results parameter as well. So these are the A and the B parameters here. And if you also look at the result summary, so here it shows some statistical properties like coefficient, standard error, p values and all. So I'm not digging into all these details because it goes beyond the scope of this talk, but what I highly recommend is it's good to look at all these properties because this will definitely help in improving the model accuracy. So for now, we are just sticking to surface layer, which is used in this model. So we'll give a new input here for new temperature. So based on that, it will generate a output of this from this mathematical model. So how we are doing is, so for example, let's say if we have a weather forecast is going to be 28 degrees, so how much crime rate can we expect from it? Or if you have during the winter, the temperature is going to be 5 degrees, so what would be the crime rate then? So what I am doing is, I simply called a predict function here, and I'm just passing this series value. So here you see the predictions. Again, so these are the predictor values, but again, taking such predictions will definitely grain of salt here. Why? Because if you observe, our scatter plot has lot of variance data, and moreover, we have just selected only the single period data here, but it's also good to look at other period data and observe how the predictions are going. So the idea behind for this is to give you a quick overview of how to deal with these kinds of linear models. And the last thing what we have is how do we plot this? Can we basically plot this? Of course, we can plot the scatter plot as we have shown above. So what I'm doing is I'm calling the abplotline method, which I've imported earlier. So I'm just passing the model results object here and followed by the other matplotlib properties like title, x label, y label here. So here you can see the plot. So it shows the scatter plot from before, and it also shows a line which describes the linear function which we have updated through a linear regression method. So I think this is a nice graphic here. It basically shows the multiple different information types. So we have passed two data sets to obtain this graph here. And it also shows our model on top of it, which shows a multiple layers here. So I think this is a nice implementation of doing an information dense visualization. So to wrap up the things, what we have covered so far is, so we have explored the different information dense visualization techniques. So we have firstly looked at aligning time series plots and comparing it properties like seasonalities and trends. And then we have also looked at scatter plot, which basically plot two variables on the same graph. And we have also discussed about a moving average method. And also finally, we also looked at a simple linear model, which basically we have obtained through a simple linear regression method. So yeah, that's all. So here are the quick references that I have considered for preparing this talk. So the book which I mentioned during my talk, this is the book. And these are some resources. So yeah, thank you so much. That's all from my end.
Hey, Kalyan, that was a really nice session.
I think I'm pretty fast going my talk.
That's fine. We do have questions for you.
Okay, so I'm happy to answer them.
I have a couple of questions for you.
Sure.
So let me start with the first one from Anurag in the crowd. The question goes like this: can you suggest some tools, techniques for visualizing textual data?
Let me be very honest. I never explored visualizing techniques on textual data. So I'm pretty not sure, because I don't want to give you false answers, because I have some idea, but I don't want to give some false answers on this concept. So I'm sorry for that. Probably I can explore it and I'll get back to you.
I think some of the ways would be, in textual data, when you're doing EDA, one of the first things you would do is, create a bag of words and then draw a bar graph with its counts. And then
Correct, but back of words, something I didn't never played with that visuals. So, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So moving on to the next ones, which I have. Okay, so there were really interesting visualizations that you showed, wherein, you were comparing the size of the army and stuff like that. Yeah. So one of the things I had in mind, so there is a fundamental data science saying, I should say, which is, correlation is not causation, but with visualization, you can actually prove the inverse.
True.
So I think it's very important to keep in mind that when you want to put up some really interesting or scientific finding out of a data set, you could really put it out as a visualization. What are your thoughts on that?
So in case if you want to better to compare a correlation on this, so probably you can compare the some correlation, and also what I suggest, you can also do some applying some gradient on the background, so it clearly shows that how the values are correlated with by highlighting the color. So that's how you can simply know that which data points or which columns have correlated from one to each other. So that's how you can easily figure out things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and in general, I think visualization is a very, very powerful thing to know. I mean,
Sorry to interrupt. Personally, what I feel, one thing is, instead of writing a lot of code, so one visual can speak more than 100 words. I mean, so if I, instead of writing a 10 lines of code, if I put a simple plot with a very in a constructive way, so it answers everything rather than writing too much lines of code. This is what I mean. Personally, I learned through my experience.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree with you, because in a data science process, visualization is the first thing and also the last thing. The first thing because you do EDA with that, and the last thing because that is where you put out your insights. So yeah. Visualization is like the
core. And that's what I mean. And moreover, that's what I mean. I was mentioning the book Visual Display of Quantitative Information that speaks exactly the same. So instead of writing tons of code, I mean, the most of the process you can simplify with visualization. So you can, you don't need to complicate things. So because at the end, when if we are communicating something to stakeholders or the clients, so it should be easy to, it should be easy for them to understand things. Though it's a technical or a non-technical, so visualization definitely helps in that case. Until unless we don't complicate the visualization.
Yeah. So what are your thoughts on, you know, open source visualization tools versus commercial ones? So there are things like Tableau and a whole set of things which are commercial, and then there are, you know, open source tools like, you know, D3JS or Dojo or, you know, stuff along those lines. What do you say?
So it's again depends upon the use case, how we are going to, I mean, so depends upon case to case. So for example, if you ask me in my personal or else my day-to-day work, so I'll go on a case by case. Sometimes I do visualizations in Excel itself, and I'll communicate the results to my managers or stakeholders. So it depends. I mean, if we need to take a call, depends upon the situation. So I mean, I'll not say that open source libraries are pretty much good than other two visualization tools, but it depends. Like depends upon the case to case. We need to follow it. I use Tableau in my regular work. I use Excel in my work. I also do visualize in Matplotlib, Seaborn, Plotly as well. So it's again, so I segregate the things from, I'll play according to case to case.
Right. And on Jupyter, I think most people first off would start with, you know, Matplotlib if they were to visualize something, and then go in, you know, the various other things like Seaborn or.
Correct. Why? Because the Matplotlib is a basic visualizer. I mean, if you are doing a data visualization with Python, so Matplotlib is a very primary library you should be aware of. Because until and unless you are not sure with Matplotlib how to play with Matplotlib, so you can't go and explore Seaborn, because Matplotlib Seaborn is built on top of Matplotlib. It simplifies some process, but until and unless if you are not aware of Matplotlib properties or things. So it is, would be difficult to, you know, go and explore Seaborn or at least even Plotly as well.
I see. Okay, we have another question from the audience. Let's go over. Could you suggest the best way to build a story in visualization for a beginner?
Story in sense of what exactly they mean?
What they mean is probably, you know, let's say you have data. How do you put it forward to your management that, you know, whatever you want to convey?
So that's what. So simply you need to start with, you need to completely make your hands dirty. You need to do data cleansing and all. So first of all, you should be aware of your problem statement. So what you want to do. You have a data. So what do you want to do from that? So you need to, put it all your points, write up your points. How do you want to do a step-by-step process? So because if you ask me my learning, I just, segregated things. I mean, I write every point. For example, if I want to clean this column, I write this one. So I design my story as a step-by-step process, even the data cleansing process. So if I write, if you are clear with your things, I mean, like how do you want to do or how do you want to play with data? So that gives you, that will definitely, you know, at the end, that will definitely create a story for you. So until and unless, if you are clear with your problem statement and what you want to achieve from it, yeah, that will definitely help you to create a story.
Yeah, so in a gist, what I understood is you need to have the story clear in your mind. You need to have your data cleansed accordingly. And then, I think a lot of insights from your PPT itself would say, you know, what kind of visualization to use where is something you need to figure out. Like you cannot really, show some, you cannot always use a pie chart. It might look jazzy, but it may not be the right one for the right kind of
visual. Yeah, correct.
Yeah, right.
Correct. So we cannot always go with the pie chart. Sometimes this simple bar chart answers everything. So, and also sometimes a simple heat map speaks everything. That's what I mean. Like, the more you simplify your plot, so you don't need to go for, that's what I was saying. So you don't need to go for a fancy suit or a fancy plot to express your story. So the more you do with simple things, it will definitely make it better.
Yeah. So more than things looking jazzy, it's more about, you know, conveying the thing. Correct. In a simple.
So you don't understand. I mean, if I create some jazzy visuals and all, so at the end, if I'm conveying that message to my stakeholder, at some point he won't understand why this reason behind all this. That's what one of my example was pie chart there. So it's just a 4 items. So there's no need to create that pie chart, I mean, with a lot of fancy colors, effects and all. So instead of that, if we are just talking about the size of 4 numbers, you simply put it as a numbers in a table or just write it in a text. That will definitely help you. Because if someone don't understand all of a sudden, what is the point of keeping this pie chart? True.
Yeah, it's been a good session and great learning all throughout. So thanks a lot for the session, Kalyan, again, about, you know, advanced visualization techniques within Jupyter. And we also spoke about, you know, advanced visualization in general. So it's been great to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I'm happy to have any questions. If you please feel free to connect me in Zulip, or else you can also connect me on my LinkedIn or Twitter as well. So these, just let me show you. So these are my Twitter and LinkedIn handles. So feel free to connect with me.
Sure. Yeah. The crowd, I'm sure the audience will be happy to connect with you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. Have a good day.